Hello, buddy. Welcome to another episode of Basement Electronics. This past summer, I went to the Toronto Maker Extravaganza and went to the InterAccess booth, where I bought this, the Atari Punk console. Now, this is a basic electronics kit intended to get beginners interested in soldering and electronics. And I thought it would be a good thing to pick up and a good way to review some of the basics when you're putting electronics together. Now, I've already done a few kits on the channel already, like I did the LED clock and I did the little video game. And I'm actually working on the radio, the AM/FM radio kit right now. But as I mentioned, I figured this would be a good way just to kind of get back in and kind of take a look at the basics of the electronics. So this kit is actually based on the NE556 timer chip, which is very closely related to the 555, which I've done a project on before, but that was just making a light blink. With this, if I remember right, you get to manipulate sound using a couple variable transistors, or variable resistors. But I can't remember exactly how it works, because it has been a few months since the Maker Extravaganza, and this thing has sat on my shelf for a little while, so I don't remember all the details. So once we get it built, we'll kind of play around with it and experiment with it a bit. So let's get started. So here's the package that I got. Move some of this stuff out of the way. First thing we're going to do is take the parts out and kind of take inventory. Of course, big magnetic speaker making everything stick to it. So here's the printed circuit board. There we go. So it has all the parts. So all the solder points listed on it. We have our chip here. We have capacitors, resistors. We're going to, so basically all the kit is soldering all the parts on. Now, the instructions for this build is available online as a PDF, and I'll link it in the description down below. So here's your battery. We'll probably put this on last. Our integrated circuit. So you'll notice that the socket has a notch in it here. And when you put it in, make sure that notch lines up with the notch printed on the circuit board. And again, when you look at the chip, you'll see the notch here, which lines up to those notches. So that'll probably be the first thing we put on. Our two variable resistors, which will go down here. Gave us some wire for hooking up the variable resistors. I'm hoping the speaker too. Otherwise, well, I have other wire I can use. Some capacitors. 103. Alright, so those two are the same, so we don't have to worry about what goes where. And then we have electrolytic, which, when you look at, goes right here. So electrolytic is C3, and they actually do have the positive marked on the board, so that makes that easy. Now the resistors. We have a large one here. Brown, green, brown. Which I have to look up because I don't have it memorized. But brown, black, orange, I do know is a 10K. Brown, black, red, which is a 1K. And then a green, purple, red, which is a 4.7K. I should remember what the... Alright, green, that's right. Green was 5, so this is actually 150 ohms. So
So, let's see here. Well, I do know that the 150 ohm goes across the volume. But I can't remember which is the 10K, which is the 1K. So give me a minute while I pull up the instructions. So I now have the instructions pulled up on screen, just off camera. And I now know where each of the resistors go. But I was right that, so we're going to start with the 556 chip. So unfortunately, one of my pins is a little bent here, so I just got to line it back up. Them in. Once it's in, just kind of push it in, grab a couple corner pins, just kind of opposite corners, kind of pull them out. It should kind of hold it in, but also let gravity do the work by holding it upside down. Grab our soldering iron, clean the tip. Stuff out of the way. So in the instructions, they give you a link to a comic that teaches you how to solder. And it's actually really very interesting little comic. It gives some really good tips. And, you know, it includes little gems like, you know, don't touch the metal tip because it's hot. Which I would hope people are smart enough to realize, but, you know, when I was about 7, I made the mistake of grabbing a soldering iron like a pencil without really thinking. But the comic does give you some guidelines about like how much solder you should use, and they actually recommend the 60%, 40% lead and tin solder, which is what this is. It also goes into explaining what rosin and flux is. So with this solder is actually hollow in the middle, and in that hollow center you put rosin in there. What the rosin does is it kind of helps pre-clean the metal pads before the solder gets to it. It's, if I remember, it's a bit like an acid. But another name for the rosin is flux. So when you hear people talking about flux, that's what they're talking about. So you have the rosin in the solder itself, but you can also get kind of extra paste stuff, and then you can get tubes of it, and it's really good if you want to kind of pre-clean your pads. It's also good if you have to remove solder. So that's nice, and so there we go. That's pretty happy with that. So next, we want to put on the capacitors. Okay. So So we'll start with the electrolytic capacitor here. I don't feel like fighting with the tape, so I'm just going to clip it off. And so remember, on the electrolytic capacitors, they are polarized. Most of them do have their negative marked on them. And then on the board itself, see, there's the little plus next to the hole on the left. So make sure the capacitor goes in the right direction. Unfortunately, that's a little wide, so I'm just going to have to straighten this out a little. Of living in Canada in the winter, your furnace is always running. So it seems. So it seems like with the heating bill too. There. So that's in place. I'm gonna solder that in. Another tip that they make on the soldering tutorial is to do one component at a time, because that's messy. Because if you put, you can put a bunch of components in at once, and I do. Yeah, if you look back at my previous kits, you'll see that I do. But they suggest doing one at a time, because when you have like a whole bunch of components in and the wires sticking out like this, it can kind of get in the way of each other. So if you do one at a time, you can make sure each one is out of the way before you do the next one. And also, when you do a whole bunch at once, you have to be a little more careful about making sure you actually get them all. Because I know I've had to go back and re-solder components because I realized I missed them in the first go. Solder looks fine. Next two capacitors are over here. Fortunately, they're both exactly the same, so you don't have to worry about which one goes where. Now, this group, InterAccess, they're kind of like a makerspace in Toronto. They have space that you can get a membership to for 24/7 access. They have open lab hours, I think they said on Wednesdays. They have there's some great workshops there from, you know, learning about electronics, and then they also, and they also have a lot of art, like art exhibits based on science and electronics, and there we go. So that one's good. There, get them out of the way. There we go. So I'm doing all the small components first because all this stuff is actually relatively easy. It's a lot easier to work with the wires than these little tiny pads. As you can see, you know what? You know what I'm doing wrong? I should be using this thing. Maybe then I wouldn't be dropping it as much and be a lot more stable and easy to work with. Oh yeah, much better. Another tip from that soldering tutorial: always make sure you hold the ends when you clip. That way, you don't go flying. Then you don't lose them in the carpet or on the floor, depending where you're working. They don't go fly pitch in the eye. Which is another thing. You should make sure to wear some sort of eye covering. Like, I wear plastic lens glasses, so that's kind of my excuse. They may not be the, technically I should be wearing better eye protection, but, well, I guess do as I say, not as I do, I guess. There's our capacitors. Next thing we're going to put on, I should probably these a little more out of the way. I'm going to do the resistors next. Now, there's a suggestion for mounting resistors. Mount them vertical. In most of the projects I've done before, they're kind of mounted flush up against the board, like this, but because of the size of the board, and in order to save space, they want you to mount them vertically. So all that means, one end is going to have to come down like this, and then you put it in like this. So that's what it means to mount it vertically. And then we'll kind of bend these out to hold them in place. Put it back in the clip. solder it in. Like so. So I just mount it in like this. Oops. Sorry for the camera shake. All right, next. We want the 1 kilo-ohm resistor in R1. So R1 is over here. 1 kilo-ohm. It's brown, black, red. Nope. There. So that's our 1 kilo-ohm resistor. So again, I like using the grips. This gives you a lot more finer, gives you a much more finer handling of the wire. Makes it a lot easier to bend. So this is R1. Now, of course, where you put the resistor, because there's, of course, the two holes, so whether you put it this way or this way, doesn't really matter. I'm just putting it this way because you have the R1 label, so may as well put the resistor where the label is. But that's just a personal preference. There's no actual requirement for that. In. That's in. R2 is the 10 kilo-ohm resistor, which goes right there. So that's U. So, I'm not sure if you noticed with the first two resistors I put in. But another thing I'm doing is I'm putting the gold band on each of the resistors on the bottom. Again, no particular reason for this. This just makes everything a little more uniform, makes it look nicer. Anyone who watches EEV blog with Dave Jones, he says if you put them in upside down, the electrons will fall out. That's, I always find that funny. But it's just a way of making it look nice. You know, if you do a project, you want to put some pride into it. Finally, R3 is the 4.7 kilo-ohm. soldering. So one thing you might have seen me just do right now is there's kind of like some metallic wool in there. And you'll see me kind of stick the iron in there and give it a bit of a wiggle. See, because you're using like a really hot tip, it's going to oxidize or basically rust on the end. And what I'm doing is I'm basically scouring the rust off the tip to keep it clean. In the soldering tutorial, they say to use a sponge, like a wet sponge. While that works, the problem is that it also cools down your tip, making it a little harder to solder. With the wool here, it doesn't cool down your tip. Alright, so we now have all the resistors and capacitors in place. And you'll notice that everything's all kind of lined up and looks nice. So I'll put this over here. And the next thing we're going to put on, this other way, the variable resistors. So with these, I can use the white wires here. We're going to want one wire in the center and then one wire on the side. And I'm going to use the right side. So first thing we're going to need to do is strip our wires. I think these are 20 AWG. Oh, these are terrible, terrible wire strippers. Let's try the 22s. There we go. Oh, nice, they gave me solid core. That makes things a lot easier. That means if I get frustrated with this, I can just go to my wire cutters and you know what? Use wire cutters, just give it a little pinch all around and you pull it off. You might bend the wire a bit, but again, just use your grips to help straighten it out. So we'll strip these. It's a bit of an art getting just how much to squeeze your cutters in order to strip your wire. Because if you squeeze too much, of course, you'll cut the wire. Don't squeeze enough and you don't cut the insulation. And it becomes a lot more difficult. Three. Oof, that one was a little long. I'll trim that later. There. Hope that didn't go in my well. Alright, so what we're going to do on the ends of each one end of each of the wires, we're going to make a little hook. There, make a little hook on each of the wires. And with those hooks, I'm just going to hook it in. And clamp it closed with your grips. This makes it a lot easier to solder your potentiometers or variable resistors. Yeah, it works. Just again, heat up the wire in the ring. Put some solder on. Wire in the ring. Some solder on. Here we go. A little crooked, so if you want to fix that, just heat it up, straighten. Straighten it out. There, one done. I'll do the other one. All right, so now that the variable resistors are done, put this in here. I'm going to put each of these in place. So again, through the hole. And just give it a bend just to make it a right angle. That way it's a little cleaner on the board. Unfortunately, one wire is a little longer than the other. That's fine. Alright, this is being difficult. So, what I'm going to do, I'm just going to do one at a time here. So, I'll flip this back over. Put one wire in. Now that's tacked in place. The other wire through. One. I'm just going to trim off some of the excess wire here. There's one variable resistor. Pre-bend these. Come on. There it is. So in case you're wondering, it doesn't really matter which wire goes into which side. The way I put it in, I put it in a way just so that the variable resistors are easier to line up once the board is sitting on the table. In the case that the lead that you're trying to clip is too short, just kind of stick your finger on the tip of it. Again, just to make sure it doesn't fly off and you lose it. All right, so guess next we'll do the speaker. Unfortunately, they didn't give me any wire for the speaker. In case you're wondering, I'm going to put that in last once all the components are on. All right, so on the speaker, you can actually see there's a plus here and a minus there. So I'm going to get, all right, so I got two wires. I was going to use red and black, but red tends to be for power. So I got blue and black. Blue for the positive end of the speaker, then black for ground, which is typical. Blue. So again, just like the potentiometer wires, we're just gonna make a little hook on one end. That's not too small. So just to make it easier, to hook it on, guess I made a little too closed. To help hook it on to the little loops, there. This side of the way. Don't think I need the clips for this part. Get that out of the way. And there. So those are in. Again, we're gonna bend these at a 90 degree angle for the board. In, just kind of bend it back on itself a bit so it doesn't fall out. Since I'm doing that, may as well put the blue one in too. Just bend it back, that might be a little too much. Thank you. go. Trim the ends. Finally, pause it in the corner. Finally, we're going to put this on. This should be the last of our soldering. There, that finishes the soldering. Put this out of the way. This out of the way. Next thing, we'll put the chip in. So look for the notch. Make sure it's lined up with the notch over here. So I actually have it upside down. So before you push it in, just check. So they actually suggest putting it on its side and just give it a little push. Make sure all the feet are lined up and straight. And then put it in. Make sure everything's lined up. Just give it a gentle little push. Make sure it goes in. And just kind of give it a little visual inspection. Make sure all the feet, like none of the feet bent, all the feet are actually in the slots. So there, done. And that's the finished product. So I'm just gonna grab 9-volt battery, plug it in. That's not a good sign. Usually just give the chip a little touch. If it's getting hot, pull the battery out immediately. So that's what it is. A little sound generator. So on our left, so that sounds like just kind of a fine pitch. And then our right. I'm not quite sure what to call that. So there it is. That is our Atari Punk console. Again, a fairly simple little project, and gives you some soldering practice and kind of. And you get something kind of neat out of the end of it. I'll make sure everything's linked down below. Like all the links, how to get this, who to contact if you want one, as well as the link to the instructions. And I'll also put a link to the interaccess.org, to the group who's responsible for this. So I'm going to turn that off. So thank you everybody for watching. I hope you found that entertaining, if not informative. And I'll see you next time. Goodbye.